company, we do trading with hedge funds. We also help them with compliance, and we get to use Go at work. I also use SCADA. We had like a web application running SCADA, and then some background tools that run using Go. I'm also a committer for a web framework written SCADA to Lyft. And then, okay, so today we'll be talking about the community around Go. We'll also talk about the philosophy that comes with the language. We'll talk also about like some of the tools that come with the language. And because not only we have like the syntax, which allow Go, but also these self tools that really help with all the daily work using Go. And then I'll cover some of the syntax just briefly. And then we'll talk about concurrency, which is one of the key selling points in Go. And when they have like many features of the language, this is one of them. So we'll start with the community. So the Go community, I think it's awesome. It's also very welcoming. And the reason why I think it's welcoming is because there are people coming from many different backgrounds to the language. I mean, there are people who use Java, C Sharp, C++, and they come to Go. But and so like static languages. But also people using JavaScript, Python, PHP, and they also come to Go. And everyone finds like a middle ground, like things that they miss from the language, and they see here. And it also like, because there are people from different backgrounds, somehow we're able to also accommodate to whatever people they need. Like, so some people, for example, never heard of pointers, and Go has pointers. But like, you can feel free to like ask questions on the mailing list, and nobody will say, oh, that's too basic, we're not going to answer that. Like, they will like see where you're coming from, and they will answer the questions. And I think that's very important in the language, because both this idea of like, feeling welcome in the language, so you feel like more willing to like, participate and to like, really be part of it. And I also think that like, you don't need a PhD to come to a language. There are some languages where like, you see kind of like, the bar is pretty high, and there are all these different concepts that you need to learn. In Go, you don't need that. You don't need to have a computer science degree or PhD. Like some people like Go with the first language that they learn, and they still able to like get going. In my case, I came to Go using SCADA before, and without obsessing learning the language, I think I was able to learn most of the language in just one weekend. It's very simple. Like the syntax is like simple, easy to follow, and you don't need to like learn the whole language to get productive, and that's you know, something that I like. Then to cover the philosophy of the language, one of the things that we like in Go is to get things done, and what I mean by that is you don't have when you're confronted with a problem, you want to write a program, you don't really have to like overthink it. You don't have to like think of all the abstractions that you need, all the different like, things. Place for the most part, once you have you know the problem, you identify the problem, you have a solution, just start coding, and then the app kind of will like flow on what you're doing. And this is like not just for Go, I mean, I'm sure you can apply that to other languages, but you can see like this philosophy applied to the standard library in Go and also to all the other libraries that the community write for the language. So, on one hand, yeah, just don't try to like be too smart in a way, just get things done. And along those lines, you want things to be simple. So in Go, you have functions, and kind of like a rule of thumb, it's not like a strict, but for the most part, you can follow it. If you're writing a function, and all of a sudden you see yourself writing 20, 30 lines long, for the most part, you can split that into smaller functions to be more specific to what you're doing. This is, again, like you will see this on the standard library in Go and the libraries, and it helps when you read the language, I mean, when you read your program, because it's just very targeted, and also it will help you write your unit tests, because it's much easier to just write unit tests for a particular function that has just one thing of very targeted areas, you know, as opposed to something that covers all kinds of corner cases. So we want you to be simple, like when you're writing programs in Go. And there are going to be things that you're going to have to embrace. Because people come from many different backgrounds, there are going to be things that you don't like. There are going to be things that you're going to miss from your language. For me, one of the hardest things was that in Go you use tabs for indentation as opposed to spaces. And before using Go, I thought that using spaces was just the only way they break code. Like, whenever I met somebody who used tabs, I thought that was horrible. And for the most part, I was lucky that, like, in all the teams I worked, we all agreed that it was two spaces, two indentation, and that was it. If somebody new came using tabs, we're like, no, you gotta change. We don't care. You need to use spaces. So I tried doing that with Go, and I was using spaces. But then I realized very soon that everyone else who was sharing code online, they all use tabs, and I just could not understand why. Like, the authors made so many good decisions writing the language. How can they use tabs? So then I figured, okay, let's just look. So like, I started searching, like, why are they doing this? And of course, like, I wasn't the first one having an issue with this. Like, there were, like, many mailing threads going on. And they had a very good explanation, which I never thought about before. The thing is, like, if you have tabs, you can then just set your ID to have, if you like two spaces, you can have a tab that represents those two spaces. Person next to me likes four spaces, no problem. Still, one tab, his ID would show four spaces. Guy across the street, eight spaces. It doesn't matter. Like, as long as we all agree just one tab, you just set your ID. So you see the code the way you like it. But then when we can all work on the same file, and my ID is not going to change all your styles when I commit code, like, we're all just going to be saving tabs. And that was kind of like a big shift for me. And now it's been over 3 years since I've been using just tabs when I work on Go. I still on my Scala side on JavaScript and all the other things, I still use two spaces. But when it comes to Go, I just use tabs. And it's just a little easier now. I can share code online, and nobody's like, oh, why using spaces when you use tabs? It's just, it's there, we're all used to. Like, my code looks the same as anywhere else is on the community. And again, like, for you, maybe spaces and tabs don't make any difference. There will be something else that you won't like. So as the idea, like, just try to embrace it, see, like, why they made this decision. For the most part, they have very good reasons why they either included something on the language or why they didn't include it. So it's just a matter of, like, you know, just look into, like, why and give it a try to see if you can be flexible. I mean, there might be cases where, like, there's just no way, and, like, some things you're just gonna hate. And that's fine. I mean, Go is not for everyone. I think it's for everyone, but it might not be. But it might take more time to get used to. But for the most part, just try to embrace it, be open-minded, and try to find out why they made such decisions. Let's see what else. So the tools. So we'll go again. So we have the language, we have philosophy, we have an idea of, like, how we write code, but then we also have a lot of tools that help you on your day-to-day. One of my favorite tools is called GoFont. GoFont is something that I think every language should have. What it does is, like, you just start writing your code. You don't worry exactly about the spaces, like, about the styles on the program that you're writing. Like, if you don't have to, like, worry about, do we agree to have a space between an open bracket? Is the closing bracket on the first, on the same line, on the line below? And this tool will take care of it. And this tool will just do for everyone. And everyone in the Go community runs all the programs through this tool. So then, like, there's no, like, if you're, like, working on a team and you have a core review, most likely you run into, like, oh, I don't like the two spaces here, or, like, a space there. I mean, I know we spend a lot of time on core reviews, like, being like, oh, I forgot to put a space here, and, like, oh, change it again. And it just, depending on the language, it's, like, hard to remember all the rules. So here we don't have to remember the rules. So as an example, so don't worry too much about the syntax, but we can see here, like, here this should be an indentation, and this should be on the next line. But when you write in code, you just write this. I have my ID hooked with that program, so when I do Control S, where I get is this. It will add the indentation and it will move the closing bracket to the next line. And like that, it will, like, change anything else. Like, if you have, like, string concatenation, it will also, like, just agree to one set. And again, like, here with this tool, it doesn't have any options. So it's not that, okay, your team uses one style, but the next team uses a different one. Like, everyone, you just run this tool, it doesn't take any parameters, nothing. You just always have the same idea. And again, so this helps because, like, so again, like, I come from using Scala, and I worked so far in three different places using Scala, and every single place had different rules about how the code should be styled. And it's a lot of wasted time, and here we don't have to waste that time. And I think that makes a big difference. And slowly I'm seeing other languages embracing this idea. Grassland has also, I mean, they're working on a tool along these lines. And last week I saw Scala is getting one tool, and it's still like early development, but there's hope they will be adopted in other languages. And sometimes like, it doesn't seem like a big thing, but like, it's huge, it makes such a big difference that you don't have to think about Scala.
But it's hard to do that once the language is already out there. You gotta start with that.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, like, I mean, it was very good, like, here, like, when they released the language, they were like, here's the, these are all these tools that we're gonna use. So then, yeah, they weren't like, I mean, people wanted to have different discussion, but they were like, no, that's it, we're set, this is a language, this is the tool, this is the tab, and it's not like a PDF or a wiki somewhere that you can change your mind or you need to, like, go and read. It's just, once you install it, it's there.
You can usually do this for your own project in most languages. I always have to build, reformat all the code,
right,
and the CI fail if it hasn't been run before you checked it in.
Yeah.
If somebody complains about formatting, I'm like, make the build do it. You can do whatever you want.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult technically, I mean, it's difficult socially to say this is the format that we're, that everyone should use when you're using this language.
You should just be a bigger jerk. No, on your project. Or your team's project.
Yeah.
But yeah, for everybody's new language.
Yeah, it's different. So this is then another tool that's very useful. GoFed. So again, like you run, most of the time you just have this hooked into your IDE. And as a parameter, it just takes the file, either a list of files, or just the one file that you change. And what you do is it will like, and what it does, it will look at your, the code, and it will try to find common programming bugs, and it will tell you about them. Common bugs, like issues they have on your program. For example, something that is kind of common to run into.
Syntax issues, real bugs.
Right, real bugs. For example, in Go you can declare a variable on the global scope, and you can also declare a variable with the same name inside your function. So when you're doing that, you're doing shadowing your variable. So then when you're inside the function, you might be thinking that you're updating the one on the global scope, but instead you're updating the one in your local scope. And so this running this tool will tell you, will give you a warning saying like, are you sure that you know what you're doing? Well, not like that, but it will warn you. And like that, there are like many other like cases that that it checks. And at this point, it's just like very automatic. Like you see that on your list, and it looks like one compiler error, and you will find. And again, like this, saves you time, that you have to do right tests for certain things. This tool will find them. And every new release, they add new rules that the community find. So they do that. Then this is another tool that comes with the language called Lint. And now there are like actually like a few more linters. And this one you check for like syntax. Syntax in the way, for example, if you have a function or a variable and it's a public function, so if I look your public API, our users are going to be able to access that function. This tool will tell you, it will check if there are comments for that function. If you don't have a comment, it will tell you, you need to have a comment, it's a public API, you need to help your users know how to use it without forcing them to read the code of your program or your library. And you will check things like that. Also, if you assign a variable and you don't use it, it will also tell you why do you assign it when you're not using it. And again, like, this is one of the tools that like, this one is actually released outside the language, so then you don't have to wait for a new release of the language, which usually happens every 6 months. If they find a new rule they want to implement, they can just release the new rule, and this tool will find it. And again, like all these three tools, one, they run really fast, so it's not that you get the advantage of all the things that you find, but you need to sit there for a minute until it finds all the problems, and there is just speed of a second. And most IDEs that support Go, they have a way to hook exactly with your control S, right? Save. So as soon as you save your changes, all the three tools run, and then you get the report right there. Yeah? If there's any problem, or you can continue with your program. Okay, so we have the language, we have the tools, and then we have tests. Again, for me, like a lot of the comparisons I do are for Scala, because I've been using Scala for like 5 years, maybe six. So when you're starting with Scala, then you need to like pick which test framework you're going to use. Some people like specs, other people like Scala tests, and I think I'm sure there are many more. And in Go, the standard library comes with its own test framework. It's very simple, so you don't have like fancy features like matchers and asserts and stuff like that. but it does just enough. So again, like, with the idea of like, being simple, it, like, it does just enough so you can write your test and you don't have the excuse of like, oh, I need to find another dependency, or like, is, I need to learn some other syntax to write my test. Here you just write Go code for your test, and they also run fast. And to give an example, this is a test function for your code. So func is what you use to define a function in Go. You need to start the name of the test with the word test, then just some name, and then that parameter that you're passing, just we always do that. This line here, if I'm actually calling my code, don't turn to test. Red is the variable that I'm going to save the result of calling this function with this parameter. And then the actual test is just this part here, the three lines. Length checks the length. But what I'm getting, so like here, this is a list of results for the particular case. So in this particular case, like if my function gives me 169 items, I know that it's okay. And when you're writing code, you need to remember that something like no news is good news. So if your test pass, you don't say pass, you don't print it, you just say nothing. But if there was a problem, that's when you say something. So in this case, if it is different than 169, then you print an error.
Is this test the same thing as error handling, or is this something you just do as development?
This is different than error handling.
Okay.
And this
it's
is like
just a development, it's nothing that you would even bend with the code.
It's just a unit test.
Right. Okay. This is for, yeah, your test to make sure that when you're writing it, you're like, okay, I didn't make any mistakes. Mm-hmm. I know it's correct. So again, so that's, you know, a simple test. And what I like about this is that then again, like it doesn't take me that long to write a test. So I can say like, oh, I'll do the test, you know, later. We need to like send this feature right now, so I'm going to like, you know, do the test next week, and then next week never comes, because next week I need to do something else. Here, like writing the code, writing the test is very simple, it doesn't distract you from writing the code, and it helps a lot. And again, it comes from a standard library, so regardless of which team you're going to be working in next year or next month, most likely they're going to be using this. Some people are developing their own frameworks, but for the most part, like very few people use those. For the most part, people sometimes try those frameworks, and then they go back to saying, okay, this is just simple. One of the ideas for the Go language is that it has to be concurrent. You need to like, it's, you know, embracing the idea of having multiple cores and servers. And now when you're writing concurrent applications, chances are you can start introducing race conditions. For those who don't know the right conditions, the idea of like you have a variable, and then one side starts writing, and then another one starts reading while the right things are going on, and then you get strange errors or information. And so if you write your test, and then when you run it, you do dash race, it will enable what they call the race detector. So again, the standard library comes with an analyzer for your code that while it's running the test, it will check if there are any potential race conditions. And if they are, it's going to report that if there was a problem, there's a chance that this is a race condition, and then you do something about it. And it works really well. And again, like, very useful. And all you have to do is add 5 more characters when you run the test. And this more. Besides the test, you can also run a benchmark. And this is something that like for a long time I wanted to do with Scala, but I just never got around to like finding which framework I want to pick. And with Go, I didn't have an excuse not to do it, because all you have to do is, when you write the benchmark to run them, it just, again, add dash bench to run the test. So you're, that's all you have to do. And again, like, it's very simple to write one. This is a benchmark in Go. So again, with func for a function, so you start with the word benchmark. And then you pass that parameter. When it was a test, it was .t, here .b for benchmark. This is a for loop in Go. Go only has one kind of for loop. There's no while loop or any other things. If you want to like, go walk through a list of something, this is the syntax that you always use. Briefly, what it means here is like, so we start at 0, and we're going to stop when this magic number decides to change, which the runtime decides what to do. And then we increment by 1. And then this is my function in my code, and then they see how fast it is. So you want to run this, the runtime Go will change this number when it finds that this function is taking kind of the same time between runs, so like keep running, when it gets stable, then it's going to be, okay, this most likely is really the normal speed for your function, and then it will stop. So this is, so here is like, if you want to run just that one benchmark, you pass the name of the function to the bench parameter. First, it will run a test to make sure that, like, before it runs the benchmark, that all the tests pass. After that, it will say, okay, everything's okay. Here it says that it ran 10 million times, and each time that it ran, it took 282 nanoseconds per operation. So they grade. So that's like the basic information. You can also pass a few more parameters, and it will tell you how much memory your function took, how many memory allocations your function took, and then there was one other thing. But again, so that you can like get like more details on what you can get. And again, so this is like the same way how like most of the code that you see online for Go look the same. Benchmark results also look the same because just everyone uses this. And I just like you see, like also very easy to write, and like you don't need this like whole setup like to get them going. Like one file can just have what I showed before plus a package name on the top, and that's all the benchmark code they interact. So again, like very like easy, doesn't get in the way. Like you want a benchmark, you want to see how fast it is, you want to like improve the speed, you don't need to do that much work to find what the problem is. And then Godoc. I actually don't get to use this tool very much, but if you are somewhere, like in the airport, and somehow you don't have internet in the airport, no, most of the time you have internet. But if you are somewhere where you don't have internet, and you need to have, find help for a particular function or a package inside the runtime, the standard library, sorry, you can use Godoc, and Godoc will give you all the help on the terminal that you need. And all you have to do is run it like this. So you do Godoc, and then the name of the package, sync, is a package in the standard library, and it will just give you all the help as if you went online. It also has an option that you can pass -http as a parameter to Godoc, and then you will actually host a website on your computer where you can like, use a browser and navigate through all the documentation, and you also have like the homepage and a few other pages from the language itself, all just on your computer. I most of the time have internet access, so just Google stuff that I need. But some people don't like that doing that, so this code of this is how the help looks on your browser. So you have a package name, a summary, and they have like all kinds of functions and all the information that you can get. You can click on those, and then here it tells you examples of how to use the code. Now this is another feature that I really like, and I actually got to use this a couple of weeks ago. So in Go, you create binaries for executing. A month ago, and my boss asked me I need to like write a program that I need to run on Linux computers, but also on Windows computers. I remember like my times when I used to work in a team that they had an agent running on C, and we needed to support different platforms, Windows and Linux. For the most part, Mac and Linux, they were all the same. We didn't have problems, but Windows was always an issue, because the developers had to like have a VM running Windows and get near the editor and all these different things, and usually that was the one that failed and nobody wanted to fix it. It was a problem. So with Go, you don't have to have a whole big setup to do cross-compilation. So I ran Linux on my computer. I was able to just write the whole program on my computer, and then to end up with an executable, what I had to do was export that variable to tell you that I wanted a binary for Windows. Then the architecture, there was a 64-bit. I would also like build a binary that was going to be a 32-bit binary. And then the third thing I had to do was run Go build. And just with those three steps, I ended up having an exe file built under Linux that I could just copy to Windows machine, and it actually worked. And it was really amazing. Like, I mean, I remember like hearing people were doing that, but I always thought, I'm sure there's some detail they need to like, do something else. You know, like
you said binary, are you sure they're not using some kind of intermediate code?
Yeah. I mean, you end up with a binary, like an EFC file.
Eventually, but they're probably cross-compiling from an intermediate code, I would assume that's a binary.
I don't really know the details of what they do, but what I do know, like all I had to do was just having the standard call installation on my computer. All I had to do was those three steps, and then well, what it does is like it recompiles the whole language for Windows, but still just under Linux, without needing to use IBM, which for me was like the big deal. Like IBM wanted to have VirtualBox running on my computer, having to go in there and build from there, just on my computer. And again, it's the same way that you can do for Windows. You can also cross-compile to NetBSD, some other BSD, also to Solaris. And you can also do even different architectures. Like if you're on a 64-bit computer, you can also compile for an ARM processor. So you can get a binary that runs on Raspberry Pi and other boards like that. And again, like this like saved me a lot of time, and it was just very nice to know that it just worked. And yeah, it worked. It was just amazing. That only three things I need to do for it to work.
So it produces statically linked native binaries, so there's no intermediate language. It's creating direct executable code for the target.
I understand that, but I'm just asking how they do it. It seems to me they're not going binary to binary, probably going intermediate
code. I'm not able to find it.
What do you mean by that? What's the question that you're doing?
Well, for example, Java uses intermediate code.
And that's the compilation point, and then it's compiled at runtime to run on the on-target system. They are compiling directly to machine code.
So
there is
no
intermediate language. They're going from source code to machine code. Directly, do not pass go.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, source code to machine code. That makes sense.
Okay.
Thanks.
So IDE, that's another part that like, I really like what it did from the language. Many times, you start a new language, you know, you're the author, you're like, okay, this is the IDE I use, you know, IntelliJ, Eclipse, or Vim, and you're like, I'm going to make sure that my language works exactly perfect on this IDE, and then the rest will just have to like copy whatever I did and like find out what to do. Here, they didn't do that. What they did, just they built, you know, those other tools like GoFont, GoLint, and they also, the runtime has these different packages that give you access to the AST tree of your source code and some other things that developers of IDEs apparently really like and find very useful. So the end result is that then they're like all the different IDEs that support Go, and for the most part they all give you the same number of features. And you can all, like, if you have a function and you're calling somewhere else, you can just one keystroke and then go to the definition. And then not just definition of something that you wrote, but you can also see the definition of code inside the standard library, or even libraries that you import into your package. And so you can indeed really navigate from all over the place, and pretty much regardless of the IDE that you use. So in my case, I use Atom, which is an IDE from GitHub, and they support it really well there. I used to use Sublime Text, and again, like all these IDEs, then these people are using Vim, and it works very well. I like Vim for the editing text files, but for IDE, I just can't get used to doing that. But some people are going really crazy about like they love it. And there's Emacs, of course, I mean, you have to support that. And then like anything else, like pretty much like, and there's also there's support from IntelliJ, there's an Eclipse plugin, and all that. So like again, like I really like this idea. I mean, what they did here, that like there are all these different IDEs and they all support the language. So it really, it's a matter of like, what do you like on an IDE? Pick it, and most likely it's a plugin that just wraps all the tools from the language to give you support for Go.
There's even an IDE support for Visual Studio.
Yes, that came out, yeah. Yes, if you're a Windows person, and well, yeah, it's Visual Studio. I know, I mean, that's pretty cool. All right, now listen to this. So when you start writing a file for Go, and the first line is the package name. And you have two options when you write code for Go. You can either write an executable, something that you will run on your computer or on a server. And the other option is to run a library that somebody is going to import into their package to use from you. In this case, package main means that this is going to be a binary. You're going to end up with something that you can execute on your computer. Then after the package, you do an import. In this case, I'm importing the log package from the standard library. And then we have this. So this is like a bare bones function. So func is, as I said before, you define a function with this keyword. Main is the entry point for an executable. This is actually the second thing that gets called. The first thing that gets called is a function called init. You don't have to define it, but if you do, that will be the first thing that gets called. Then is package main. So here we just have open and close parentheses and then the brackets. Now, if you go and try to compile that with go build, you will get this error. You will say that you imported it, but you didn't use the log package. Go, this is one of the things that some people have a hard time with. Go is very picky. If you import something into your code, you need to use it. If you don't use it, you don't import it. And the same way with a variable. If you declare a variable, you need to use it. If you're not using it, why do you have it there? People sometimes have a problem with that. Because they're like, oh no, I'm just doing it fast now, then I want to delete it. Most of the time, you don't delete it. At work, we had these hundreds of files, and every time I work on a new feature or I fix a problem that we have or anything like that, I look at our import list, and most of the time, there's at least one or two that we don't use anymore.
Sloppy coder would just write, define x, and then say x equals x.
Right, so if you want, you can do that. It's not going to be, you're trying to trick me, I'm not going to allow that either. But, there are ways around it. But you don't have a flag on the compiler. They can be like, just give me a warning or be more relaxed. It's like, no, like, you import it, you use it. Now this helps you because by being very picky when you import, then this helps with compilation time. It does. You can when you compile your program, the first time it will do a full compile of your program, but then as you make changes, it will try to do just incremental compiles. So just the things that you change and are used in other places I want to be recompiled, the rest just stays the same. And so this idea of not having all kinds of imports from all over the place that you don't use helps with the speed of the compilation. But this is new and easy way to fix it. All you have to do is this is what we had before. Just import and not using it. Just use it and then happens. So that's the idea. So that's one. So we have functions, then this is how you declare, one way to declare a variable. Just very simple, var for the keyword, this is the name of the variable, and then we're assigning a string. Now in this case, so Go is a static language, and you have types, but when you declare a variable, you don't have to be explicit about the type, it will infer the type based on whatever you are saving in there. So you have this, and then the next line, you try to assign a number to the variable, you're going to get a compiler error saying, no, this is a string, you can put a number here. So that's one way. If you want to be explicit with the type, which sometimes you want, all you have to do is just add the type after the name of the variable. And then you're being explicit about, okay, this is a string. And that's really clear. So this is the syntax for declaring a variable, like I said before, on the global scope. And something else I should say, so in Go, you have functions, but you don't have classes. So if you're used to Scala, Java, and you have your objects and your classes and your traits and functions and methods and stuff like that, that's not the case. Like in Go, so this is a variable that you can see across the same package. So you have package main, all the variables that you declare on the global scope, regardless of which file it is, they all have access to it. It takes some time to get used to, but this is how they came up with. This is how you can declare a variable on the local scope inside your function. So you don't use the var keyword, you just type the name, and then colon equals, and then the string. This is usually how you declare your variables inside your function. You can still use var if you want inside your function. It doesn't buy you anything more than just, if you like it better, you can do that.
This colon equal restricted to local scope?
Yeah, so if you try to do that on the global scope, you get an error message from the compiler saying that you can't do that. I can't remember exactly the error, but it's an error. Yeah, so before I said you can do an executable or you can write a library. So in this case, when you see something other than main, you know that this is a library. So the package name for the library, in this case, notification. Now here I have func email. Now notice how email start with a capital E. This isn't that I just decided I need to do email with capital E. Capital letter or lowercase letter have a meaning. in Go. So for most languages, you're used to the idea of you have a public function or you have a private function. In Go, you have exported and unexported, and there are very small differences. So they tell you, like, don't really think about it, public or private. I don't remember exactly the differences, but for the most part, you can think of the same way. Like, so something with a capital letter means it's a public function. Also a variable, if you type a variable with a capital letter, it's public, so people outside your package will be able to read or to call your function. And again, this feels weird. I mean, now I'm explaining about it, I'm like, wow, that looks strange. But after you use it for a while, and it's like, oh yeah, it's capital letter, it's public. Then you have issues on your own language, and then you start using capital letter for functions, and then doing core review, they ask you, why do you do that? I'm like, oh yeah. But yeah, so this is in your public. If it was lowercase, then only this package notification will be able to call this function. This is something else, something neat, I think, from the language. So now email is being more advanced. It's taking parameters. So you're going to have a to, a from. Now notice how, like, we have to, comma, from, and then string. If you have two or more parameters that are going to be the same type, you don't have to repeat the type all the time. You can just do that. You see the string only after the last one. Save you a little typing.
So if you have more than one type, you put a semicolon between them or something?
You just put a comma. Like, if you wanted like two from the word string and then a number, you can just do comma, count, int. Okay. You can just do the comma, the name, and the type, comma, name, and type, as many times as you want. So that's, for, and you don't have to like, use this syntax. I mean, you can like just repeat string all the time. It will work too. And now, so we have, it's a public function, it takes two parameters to a string, and now we return. So after the closing parentheses, here it returns something that is of error type. And error type is built into a language. And this is like something that like you don't like create your own like error messages. I mean, error types for the most part. For the most part, you return that error type from your function when there's an error. And then here we can have some code. And there's a lot more for the syntax. I didn't think I had enough time to cover everything, but there's this website, the tor.golang.org, which I think everyone should come and see the website. It's like a kind of like a tutorial-based website that walks through the whole language and the syntax with examples, and then you actually get to like try the syntax on the browser without you having to install Go on your computer. I have a screenshot here. This is more or less what it looks like. So you have some explanation here. And then this is where there's going to be code. And you can click run. And it will send this to some Google server. It will run. And then it will put the result down here. And so you can try the syntax. You can try different things, make changes to the website itself there to like play around with it. And again, I think like it's like a nice and easy way to like get started with it. So you don't have to like commit to say, okay, I'm going to install Go on my computer, which actually is not very hard to do, but still, sometimes you don't want to like, do all that. So just go to the website, start playing with it, and get a feeling for it. Oh, and also, this guy, he's the gopher. This is the mascot, the icon, the symbol of Go.
I really want his eyes to follow the mouse.
So, that's that. And then also this URL, play.golang, this is just a full screen of the where you can like write code again and get the results down here. And then you have things like format, so you can even like try the GoFont is connected there. So you can run the example that you type there. And then you can also share. And this is what most people use on the mailing list. Like if you have a problem, you're writing something and you're stuck somewhere, you come here, you copy and paste from your code, you make some changes if you need to, and then you share that on the mailing list. And so then people will like be able to like see exactly the error message that you're getting, and right there make changes, and then when they click share, they will get a new URL, and then they will tell you, okay, the solution is here, the URL link. And again, very useful, like once you get going with this idea, to be able to like share codes. That you can actually run and see the problem that somebody is getting. Again, instead of having to make a dummy project on your computer, create a file, copy and paste. It's just right there from the browser. And yeah, so we got that. Now, I can either talk about concurrency or answer any questions that anybody may have. I know you can do both.
Is there any sort of REPL support?
No, well, there is actually. If you look for Golang REPL, there's not like an official one, but there are a few people that started their own. The compilation is, like, for the most part, people get used the Playground, because the compilation is so fast when you write something that they found that, like, it wasn't really that you needed to have REPL.
I'd be really interested to hear about concurrency.
Okay. Cool. So, concurrency uses what they call goroutines. Goroutines are something similar to threads, with the difference that you can have a lot more goroutines run on the same thread, and then internally they have a scheduler and some other magic that it will like decide like what to run when, to run your code like more or less in parallel. So we have goroutines, and they also are very efficient, so you shouldn't be afraid of like running thousands of goroutines inside your program. If that's what the use case that you have, just go ahead. Like, they won't like use a huge amount of memory unless you know, you're copying a lot of things inside each goroutine. But like, the overhead is very minimal. So you have this idea of goroutines. Some people call them green threads, with some language out there that like, they find like, similarities. So they're like more lightweight than the Java threads, to give a comparison. So this is one way to create a goroutine. So we have our function. So in this case, it's a private method, because any function, because they with lowercase. This function takes this symbol here, the square bracket, means that this is a list of strings. So URL is just a list of strings. In Go, they call them a slice. And a slice is actually a pointer to an array. But for the most part, you just think it's a list of strings, and that's all thing to know. So here we have our for loop. Range is how you tell the language that you want to like, walk through a list or something. So and we assign each line from the list to the variable u. So we assign the first one to u. And here, when you have the go keyword, that means that whatever is after that, it will run on its own goroutine. So this fetch u is some imaginary function that you know you can write. They will, let's say, fetch the content of that URL. So the idea is like, so you have the function, when it starts running, it comes here, it goes to the first URL, it goes and starts fetching. It doesn't wait for this to finish. It will go back to the top, go to the second one, and it will keep going, and it will keep like accumulating all the goroutines. And then when it's done, it reaches the last URL, then it just will go ahead and it will end. So if you just write this on your app and it's a command line program, then the app won't actually wait until all this is done. You're going to like, lose the job that you're doing here and you'll just exit. A few slides then later show you how to like fix that problem. But all you have to do like to start a coroutine is just put go in front of a function and that's it. Something else that the language gives you to work with concurrency is what they call channels. Channels help you synchronize communication among different coroutines. One example is, let's say you know, you're creating a search engine, and then you have your user enters a keyword searching for holidays. Then let's say you have like several backend servers. You can create like three, let's say you have three servers. You can create like three different coroutines that will go to each of the servers. And then whenever like one replies, you will listen, each time that you send the goroutine to start, you will have a channel that will send you the reply. So as soon as you get one reply, you can then just continue and give that to the user, even though there are two are still working. So you have to like, you can pick the fastest response based on which server responds faster, and then move on and give the users the result that they want. To see an example of like what channels look like, so we have a for loop, and then we have inside the for loop we have a select statement. So this thing here means that this function returns a channel. So a channel is something similar to like a promise from other languages, like not exactly, but it's the idea that like there's some work going on, and at some point in the future you're going to get something. So there's this one, and then there's this one. So in this case, we have like two coroutines that are going to send information through a channel. So then you come here, so then when the program is running, it checks on the first one. So save private, this is, you know, let's say we're saving some data in a database, and we want to have like a timeout for saving. We want to like wait, you know, 3 minutes for the user to like just sit there waiting for the save. If it didn't save, just, you know, try again or something. So in this case, it will check if there's something here. If there's no response from the channel, it will go to the next one. This one is a built-in channel thing timer inside the runtime. Here, what it does is like once it will give you a value on the channel 1 second after it was initial called the first time. So then, like if it doesn't, it hasn't been a second yet, so just, you know, 100 milliseconds. It will come back here. If this save, then it will call this one, this thing inside, and then it will exit. But if it didn't, it will just keep going, try here, and then when this second is up, then this will be executed. The concurrency for Go, something that I find easier to deal with is that you don't have this idea of like an async API when you're writing the code. Like internally, if you're, you know, fetching data from a URL, or you're doing I/O stuff on your hard drive, all the way down, hidden from most users, is this asynchronous stuff going on. But for the user, you can just happily block and be like, look, I'm saving data, I just want to sit here until I get my data back, or until I get a notification from the database that it was saved. And you don't have this like idea that, no, you shouldn't be doing that because you're wasting coroutines or you're wasting threads. No, like, my app needs to be passed, and I'm going to block here until I'm done, and then you move on. And that's, you're like encouraged to do it, as opposed to like, you know, some other languages that you're encouraged not to block. All right. So, and you can have as many case statements here as you need. And you can also like have like different types. So for example, here, you actually, the reply from this function, the channel, it just kind of an empty struct, they call it. It's like an empty something. But then up here, we can actually get like some other information. We can actually get like the ID from the database row that you saved, or like how many items were saved. And you can have like different like types of responses here, which like in some languages, you know, when you have like a future, for example, you need to have a specific type for the future. Here you can like mix whatever like data you need. And it's not strict about which type. So that's one part. Then I said before how like you can start many coroutines, but then if your program finishes, then you're done and like all that is lost unless it was saved, but you know. That's when wait groups come into play. So here, so you start by declaring the, so it's inside the sync package, that's the wait group. So you declare this variable, the wait group. Then we have the normal, you're going to like walk through the URLs. This is important here. So we're adding one, because like I'm about to add a coroutine, so I'm adding one to a counter, that's internal. Then this is called an anonymous function, and this could be just another function, but I wanted to show that like you need to call gt.done to tell the wait group that this one is going to be done. The defer means this line will run when this function ends. So until, you know, like usually you type something on the last line, I think the last, but for things like this or releasing a log from mutex, you can just, as soon as you declare something, you can be defer something else, so you don't have to, you don't risk forgetting doing that.
And would that still run if through an exception below or something, or if it returned?
Yes, if there's a return, is that an exception which they call panic in Go, and if there's something that made this end, defer will be called. So here it's safe to use in that area. So we walk, we add one, when we're done inside this, we deduct one. We go through the list, we add in, you know, 100 URLs to get. And then outside the for loop, you go this, wait group of wait. So then this will wait until the internal counter that it has goes to zero. So then you have all these things running in parallel, like it doesn't matter if the other websites are slow or not. And you don't have to be, okay, today this takes 2 minutes, so I'm going to wait 2 minutes. And then two more something else happens, you know, and the 2 minutes are not enough, so you need to change it. Here it's like, you, as long as you know how many things you're doing, then, and you detect, then this is going to run. Yep.
I don't quite understand, the defer call is very cool, but I don't quite understand the need for it. Why not just put the call to WG done at the end of the function?
I could. Here, I just wanted to show the defer while I was showing the wait group. Yeah, for something like so simple like this, most of the time you just see a call done here. Most of the time, defer is useful when you have, you know, like 10 lines or something. Or if you're calling like some other function inside, and it's kind of like a chain of functions going on underneath, until you've been, okay, I'm going to let pass the wait group variable to all of those functions, and then I need to make sure that all the way at the bottom I call done. You can just be like, okay, I know there's a whole change, I'm checking when it's going to be defer done. And then whenever like one of those 10 functions are done, either because they're done doing the job and it was good, or there was some kind of problem, then these up here are going to be, okay, something happened, it's done.
It's kind of more about keeping your resource handling together. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you are declaring something up here, and then you're immediately saying, by the way, when this is done, it's done, finish it, close it, whatever the resource is. So keeping the two things visually close together in the language.
Right. And yeah, the defer is not just for wait groups. You can do defer with anything. Like if you know, if you open a file, for example, and then you need to now release the resources, it, like as soon as you open it, you can be like, okay, I'm done. Like defer done, you know, close, and then do all kinds of things that you need to do with the file. And now again, if there's a problem or like something, you don't, the way I see, like I don't forget to close it. And other people are like, so you also don't have to like, you know, pass and make sure that like all the way down there. Because if then you're looking at this one function, you're like, why am I calling done here? Like what is this, you know, like wait group? And then you need to like go all the way up, oh, I'm passing all the way like 10 functions up. And this way, like, okay, wait group is right here, 4 lines below, I'm doing done. So it's kind of like, you keep the focus and what we're doing there.
That's cool.
And yeah. But again, in this case, yeah, it's kind of like a silly example.
I would think without defer, though, you also lose the benefit of guaranteed execution if there's an
if you're panicked on the get, it's not going to execute.
Right, that, yeah.
Then you're going to have a problem.
Yeah,
you still want it to run if you panicked on the get.
Whoa.
But I'm sure there's cases, yeah, totally.
Yeah, so, yeah, kind of like, yeah, it's safe to use defer. One thing to notice, so while defer is very useful, if you're running a very tight loop where like, you know, nanoseconds make a difference on your application, defer is actually slow. So if you're like down to the, you know, like, oh, 2 to 3 nanoseconds, this is horrible, don't use defer. You need to like do the extra work of like passing the variables or like do whatever work and check and return and check for all the possible errors. But for the most part, you know, if the code can handle a few extra nanoseconds, just call defer and it will work. So it's there, and then...
Now I'm immediately plotting to write a defer macro, because that's cool.
And then there's also mutex. So this is just, you know, the normal, like, sometimes having a whole setup with channels and coroutines is just too much work. Sometimes all you need to do is just, you have a variable and you set a mutex, and depending on what you want to do, you can do a read mutex, so you can just have many coroutines read from one variable, and it's fine. Or you can have a write mutex, and in that case only one routine, a goroutine, so it will then get in, make changes, and once it releases the log, then all the readers can come and read. One of the places where you normally see mutex is like in Go, the map structure is not thread safe, and they did this because they decided that like for the most part, people will be able to just handle a map and they don't need the thread safety penalty for synchronization. But if you do, then you just use a mutex on your map. So you go, you lock it, you add a value, release the log, and then keep going with Go. Most of the time when we start using Go, we are like using coroutines and channels all over the place. So for sometimes most simple at like reading a map, we use a coroutine and select and then you realize like you don't have to like add like 20 lines of code just to read, you know, map. Just use a mutex and it's fine. That's it. Thank you. So you know that's my Twitter. If you have any questions, my email is diego@fmbwizard.com. And you know, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to talk about Go a little more.
Good presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Just because it was on my mind from an earlier conversation, do you, is, are there any good GPU libraries for Go, by chance?
Good GPU? I don't know.
Okay.
I haven't looked yet. Maybe, I'm not sure. Yeah, that's actually something that personally I would like to like get into. I haven't really found like that much time to like get work on it. Oh, but speaking of libraries, one of the, another thing that I mean, I love the language. I mean, I'm actually trying to like move our whole web application from Scala to Go. They told me I had to wait. There are features that we need to implement, and we just can't, you know, like hold it. But you know, they told me maybe at the end of the year they'll do that. But one of the things that, well, one of the many things. But the lack of Go is like, so you have the standard library, and the standard library comes with a lot of the things that most people need. For example, that one tool that we use in the company, so we have, on one hand, we need to read parameters from the command line, and we need to do logging, we need to parse JSON, we need to do HTTP requests to our web application, and we need to save data to our database. We're using MongoDB right now there, and then what does it do? And then some math stuff going on. Oh, it also reads CSV files from the file system. So we do all that, and the only external library that I had to get was the one to read MongoDB information. So all like CSV, JSON, XML, if we need to, and having command line parameters, they're all part of the standard library. So for the most part, you can do a lot without any third-party library. And I think, I mean, that's huge, but like the same thing, like something in other languages, like you get all the different options of what you can do, and they all have, you know, they all get, this is good, this is bad, you know, like, sometimes you run into problems with third-party, you know, libraries, but in Go, you, like, for the most part, you have a lot just built into there. And then, at this point, Go is 5 or 6 years, I think, old, so you find libraries for most other things, but I think that's also very important, that like, there's just so much. So on one hand, they give you a lot, but it doesn't feel like totally bloated, that like, oh, I wish, you know, it was simpler, or like, it's so complex. It's just like, if you need it, it's there. If you don't need it, don't worry, and just keep going. Oh, one more thing that I forgot to talk about. There's also this thing that like, you can have your program running, and then with just very few, like 2 or 3 lines of code, you can then have metrics all built in from the language. So you can see how many garbage collections happen, and how long they took, and all kinds of things. They're like, I don't know, like 50 different values. And you can also add your own counters to it. Make sure to do like a part two. But yeah, so that's another thing, that it's just like, they really thought about a lot of things with the language. I thought that, you know, just giving you like the runtime information and the garbage collections and all that is very handy. But yeah, I guess I should just stop. Yeah. Well, thanks.
Thanks again.